Hey guys, what is up? How are you? I feel like it's been so long since I've sat down and filmed a video, and it really has been because the three videos I filmed before my Iceland video were pre-filmed, so I haven't been in front of a camera in a while, but I'm really excited about today's video because it's answering a question that you guys have been asking me so much recently, and that is, how do I afford to travel? So I think there are two parts to answering this question. One, I feel like you guys want to know how I personally am in the physical space to travel as much as I do. And then the second part of it is more just general tips on how to travel on a budget. So I'm going to be answering both parts of those for you guys today, and I'm just going to dive right in. So I'm going to start off with the personal part of it. So how am I able to travel as much as I do? Okay, so I'm gonna give a little bit of backstory, and I feel like for those of you guys who have been watching me for a while, probably know some of what I'm about to say. But at the same time, I don't really talk about this stuff that often on my channel, so maybe you don't. But anyways, about a year and a half ago, I graduated from college. I went to UCLA and I graduated with a Bachelor of Arts in Communication Studies, and I actually finished in 3 years. So I graduated when I was 20 because I was a year younger in high school, and then I graduated a year early from college. And once I graduated, I moved back home for the summer to work, which I had done all throughout college because the hometown that I grew up in is just really good for work and to really just get money in the bank in the summer. So I did that all through college, and I did the same thing the summer after college. But that summer was different because, of course, now that I graduated college and I had this piece of paper telling the world that I was qualified to enter the workforce, I was frantically looking for a job and really thought that I had to move to a city and find an entry-level job in communication when the fall came around. So that's kind of how I spent my summer. I was like on Craigslist, looking at apartments. I really thought I was gonna move to New York City. That's what I told everybody my last semester of college. That was like my plan. I was like, yeah, I'm gonna move to New York City. I'm gonna get a job in PR and advertising, and that's gonna be my post-grad life. But that summer, I started to slowly realize that that wasn't really what I wanted. And as I started going through the job opportunities, I started to realize more and more that those opportunities weren't really calling my name, and I didn't feel drawn to move to New York City or anything involved in that plan that I had made for myself. So that was when I kind of had the realization, I am 20 freaking years old. I mean, I'm 21 now, but I was 20 then. And this was the first time in my life where I didn't have to mandatorily, is that a word? Mandatorily? I don't know. School wasn't mandatory. Nothing was tying me down. It was the first time where I really had the world at my fingertips, and it was my decision what I was going to do. And I was asking myself, why, out of all the things that I can do with my life in this moment, why am I gonna go do something that I'm not 100% passionate about? And that's when I decided to really hone in on my intuition and do what felt right, which has led me to do so many things that I am so passionate about. One of those obviously being travel, and then making more videos and just doing things that I actually love. And I can genuinely say the past year has been the best year of my life, and that's because I'm doing things that actually feel right. I've really been following my intuition and just really living my passion. So yeah, with all of that said, I feel like that context was necessary in order to explain my current life situation, but I know a lot of you guys want to know how I actually get the money in the bank to be able to travel as much as I do. So to break it down for you guys, 50% of my income comes from little side jobs. So I nanny, I work at a clothing store, and I tutor on the side, and all of those jobs are super flexible. So as you guys might be able to tell, I'm not home right now. I'm actually in the Netherlands. I've been here for about 3 weeks, I think. So yeah, those jobs have a lot of flexibility, and I kind of have personal relationships with each of my bosses, which makes it really good so that in times like these, when I'm away for a while, it's no problem. And then the other 50% of my salary comes from YouTube, which is freaking insane to me, and I owe all of that to you guys. So thank you guys so much for giving me this platform to be able to do this and earn money from it. It just blows my mind. But yeah, that's basically how I make money. 50% of it is from little side jobs. 50% of it is from YouTube. So yeah, that's pretty much how I afford to travel. And now to get into some general travel tips. I have my journal right here because I wrote all of it down. I don't want to forget anything. So if you see me looking down, I'm looking at my journal. But yeah, I basically was trying to think of how I budget when I'm planning a trip. And I kind of narrowed it down to four main categories to budget for when you're planning a trip. So the four categories are one, flights, of course, two, accommodations, finding hotels, three is food, and four is activities. So those are the four main things that I budget for when I'm planning a trip. So number one, finding inexpensive flights. I feel like this is an art form that I am slowly perfecting, and it blows my mind that some people, well, it doesn't blow my mind, but for example, I was FaceTiming with my friend Andrew the other day, which you guys know, he was in my Paris vlogs, and he's in Madagascar right now. This is like so irrelevant. But anyways, he was looking for a flight to get to Sydney, Australia from Madagascar, and he was using a travel agency that told him the flight was gonna be like $2,000. And I was like, dude, we live in the 21st century. Go online, look at Google Flights, look at Skyscanner. There are more cheap options, and now he got a better option. Let's stay on track here. Okay, finding inexpensive flights. My first stop is Google Flights, and I love Google Flights because it gives you a calendar view. So you put in your point of origin and then your destination, and then it shows you the price of your ticket on each date with the calendar. I'll put a little picture right here so you guys can see, but it's really, really handy. So that's the first place that I go. The next place I go is Skyscanner, and I normally just use the app on my phone, but I'm almost positive they have a website as well. But Skyscanner is great because it also has the calendar view, but it also gives you some options that other websites don't give you because sometimes they're inconvenient. What I mean by this is, like, if you're going on a long haul flight, it'll give you certain layovers that are a little bit inconvenient, but in the end are a lot cheaper. Next is Expedia. This is kind of like an OG flight finding website that I have used forever. Another great thing about Expedia is you can create an account. So whenever you book a flight, you're collecting points so that eventually you can get free flights, which is really awesome. The next website I use is Kiwi. And I really like Kiwi because they have this certain section that gives you the cheapest flights. So you just put in your home airport and then it tells you the cheapest places to fly. And you don't even give them a date. It just tells you the cheapest deals they can give you, because sometimes there are like weird flukes where certain dates going to certain origins are super cheap. Especially right now, I'm in Europe and I've been keeping my eye on my Kiwi app on my phone, and there are like $12 flights to other countries, which is just insane. And then just a few general tips when booking a flight. One, they always say to use an incognito tab, because when you keep looking for a flight on a public browser, sometimes the prices can go up. I haven't really seen a difference with this. Better to be safe than sorry, I guess. And then another tip is to find flexible dates. So if possible, if you're able to have flexible dates, always search for your flight with that in mind, because sometimes booking a flight on the 15th versus the 16th can be way more expensive because of a weekend day or because of a holiday. So it's always just good to keep that in mind. Also, there are like little kids screaming outside the window. I don't know if you guys can hear that. Okay, so now moving on into category number two, finding inexpensive accommodations. So of course, the cheapest place to stay when you're traveling is a hostel, which is not for everyone, but it can be super, super fun, especially if you're traveling by yourself, because you can meet so many people and it can just be a really fun environment to be in. It's obviously super cheap. Normally you're in a dorm room, so you're staying with a bunch of different people in the same room. There are private options in some hostels. I use Hostel World. It's an app. I don't know if it's a website as well, but Hostel World is great for finding hostels. I don't normally stay in hostels when I'm traveling, but it is sometimes an option. My favorite thing to use when I'm traveling is Airbnb. I'm not sponsored by Airbnb. I wish I was sponsored by Airbnb, because I cannot say enough good things about Airbnb. I seriously love it. It literally has the option to rent out a freaking mansion, and then you can also rent out a room in somebody's house. So when you go on the website, you can set a price range. So usually I set it for under $100, and then you can select whether you want it to be the whole apartment or the whole house, or if you just want a room in someone's house. It's also awesome because it gives you a map view, so you can put in your destination and then you can find places in certain specific areas, and on the map, on the little pin, it has the price. So yeah, Airbnb is literally my favorite. Another thing that I really love about it is that you have a host, because normally you're staying with somebody in their house. Well, I guess if you're renting an entire house, you probably don't see your host that often, but regardless, you have one host who owns the property, who normally you are in contact with. And when you have a host, you have a local perspective on wherever you're traveling. So now that I got those two main expenses out of the way, flights and hotels, those are really non-negotiable. You need those, you need a flight to the place, and you need a place to sleep at night. Once those are all sorted out, I am budgeting for food and activities. And now it really depends on where you're traveling because you really have to look at the cost of living in the place that you're traveling. So for example, when I was traveling in Asia, the cost of living is way, way, way lower than the cost of living in Iceland. The bottom line is it's really important to look into the cost of living in the place you're traveling to before you get there so that there are no surprises when it comes to how you're gonna budget for things like food and activities. So when it comes to food, obviously when you're traveling in a place like Iceland, you are going to buy your groceries at the grocery store and not eat at a restaurant if you're trying to live on a budget. I didn't eat at one single restaurant when I was in Iceland because the restaurants were so expensive. I got all my food from the supermarkets and cooked it in my Airbnbs. Even then, it was expensive. So food was something that I had to budget for. But in places like Asia, you can afford to eat out every once in a while and go to a cafe or go to a restaurant and you won't be breaking the bank. So yeah, that's pretty much what I wanted to say about food. Also, always ask the locals because the locals will know what spots are not overpriced. In a lot of touristy areas, they really exploit the tourists and they tend to overprice things. So definitely ask local people, your Airbnb host, if you're staying at an Airbnb. Moving into the last category, activities. Okay, so I like to get to where I'm going first and then plan my activities. I know sometimes people like to have all their excursions all lined up, but in my experience, I feel like getting to a place, talking to people, figuring out what excursions you really wanna do, which ones are worth the money, whether you're able to do it without a tour group, and all things like that. For example, a lot of people ask me what tour I did when I was in Thailand, when I was in Maya Bay, which is a really popular tour to do when you're on Koh Phi Phi. So if you look online, I'm pretty sure you'll find tours for like $70 or $80 per person and you're on a boat with like 100 people, which I was not interested in at all. So instead, once we got to Koh Phi Phi, I talked to this local fisherman and he offered me and my mom a private tour on his little boat. I promise it was not sketchy. He was the sweetest little man. And me and my mom got a private tour at the crack of dawn before all the big tour boats were out for $40 United States, which was like the best experience ever. Of course, sometimes it's not possible, and if you're traveling with a lot of people, you wanna have it already set up. But another thing is, if you're traveling alone and you're staying at a hostel, sometimes you wanna wait and get to that hostel and see if you can plan your excursion with a group of people at your hostel, because then it'll be cheaper and it'll be more fun. But yeah, I think those are all of the tips that I have to share with you guys. Another just general tip before I leave is just do your research before you go. I know I've said a few times that I don't really like to do a lot of planning before I go, which is totally true, but I do like to do some research so that you can get an idea about the place you're going, look up some common scams so that you don't get scammed as a tourist, which is always a possibility. And that's my last tip, is just do some research. I feel like this video was like a little bit all over the place. I thought it was gonna be a little bit more organized, but I feel like I got a little carried away when I was talking about random things. But yeah, I hope this video was helpful. I know you guys have asked for it for so long, so I'm really excited to finally be filming it for you guys. Thank you guys so much for supporting my channel. I seriously wouldn't be able to travel as much as I do without you guys. And hopefully I'll have a fun Netherlands video coming soon. So yeah, thank you guys so much, and I will see you in my next video. Bye!